I never thought I could combine my passion of graphic design, because I love graphic design. It's part and parcel of who I am. And I'm a sports fanatic. So to be able to take those two passions of mine and merge those into one and do it for over 35 years has been a real blessing. I consider myself really lucky, because I never really consider this work. There's sometimes it's difficult to do proposals or whatever that are part of the business scheme, that's what comes at you. But to be able to do this consistently for 35 years is quite a privilege.
Then you are in Australia right now.
You're talking NBA basketball. You're talking great teams. You're talking great individual players.
Takes it off and there's number 23. And of course, Johnny goes nuts.
We're all getting goosebumps thinking about it now.
I just tried to go out there and play my game.
I have no idea what you're talking about, Adam. I don't like anybody. I'm not a people person.
Grant, you made the pass. Yes. Christian, can you catch the ball? Yes.
All the stars were aligned and all the muscles fired at the right time. And I was able to get off the ground and throw one down.
I was saving that as a surprise for you.
And now, introducing your host for In All Airness, Adam Ryan.
Welcome to episode 93. Thanks for joining me. Today, I'm excited to welcome sports branding pioneer Tom O'Grady to the show. In 1990, Commissioner David Stern named Tom the NBA's first full-time creative director. We discussed the lasting impact Tom and his team had on the look and feel of the league during the 1990s and beyond. We go behind the scenes on the creative direction of 1992's Dream Team, the Phoenix Suns' 1993 rebrand, fascinating details on how the NBA was broadcast on TV, and the introduction and early days of NBA.com. Plus, we touch on Tom's key role in the brand identity creation of mid-90s expansion franchises, the Toronto Raptors and Vancouver Grizzlies, and even talk about a great what-if New Jersey's almost rebrand from Nets to Swamp Dragons. All this and more in one of the most entertaining conversations I've enjoyed yet. Show notes for this episode, including links to numerous topics covered, will be available at inallairness.com/93. Now, onto the show. My guest today is a pioneer of sports branding. Commissioner David Stern named him the league's first full-time creative director in 1990. During his 13-year tenure, he was tasked with shaping one of the world's most recognizable brands, the NBA. Today, he's a partner and chief creative officer of Gameplan Creative, a branding agency in Chicago. Tom O'Grady, thanks for joining me.
Thank you, Adam. It's a pleasure to be speaking with you.
I'm really looking forward to chatting with you today. Before we focus on your time working for the NBA, you're Chicago born and raised. What are a few of the sports-related memories that may spring to mind from your childhood years, Tom?
I've been very lucky to grow up in a very sports-crazy city that Chicago is. We have very long traditional sports teams that are kind of the fabric of Chicago. Teams like the Chicago Cubs, the Chicago Bears, Blackhawks, Bulls, and Chicago White Sox. And these teams have been around for each one of them for, you know, nearly a century. So there's a lot of affinity to the teams, and there's a lot of passion behind these teams. And their brands are overall very traditional, classic brands. The Blackhawk uniform might be one of the nicest, most beautiful uniforms in sports, and there's a mass following of these teams. And Chicago's a great city, but its weather is challenging sometimes. So people are indoors quite a bit during the winter months. So teams like the Blackhawks and the Bulls have high attendances because people are looking for things to do in the winter time. And once they get a chance to break out and enjoy the summer, they fill up the ballparks on the north side of Chicago for Cub games, and often the same thing on the south side for White Sox games. So it's a very sports passionate town, and I grew up in that environment. I had two uncles who played high minor league baseball, AAA baseball, many years ago, and they were the ones that kind of got us all interested in sports. And so we'd go over for family events, and we'd pull out the catcher's gloves. They could throw fastballs pretty good, so we'd play catch. And in the neighborhoods, we'd go to the different schools and parks and play sports year-round. In the spring, it was baseball. In the summer, it was baseball. In the fall, it was football. In the winter, we play in the frozen ponds, ice hockey. And back into the spring, we go play basketball. So our way of staying out of trouble back in Chicago was to just get outside, play sports, and keep your nose out of other people's business. So I've always been fortunate to be connected to sports, and really started following this maybe when I was 7 or 8 years old. And so I've got great memories of phenomenal athletes, Walter Payton, Bobby Hull, Ron Santo, and Ernie Banks, and of course, Michael Jordan. So sports is really a big part of Chicago. And as a kid, I dove right in, and a lot of my friends did too. And I have friends even today that we attend a lot of games together because that's just what you do here.
Yeah. Well, obviously you've got a big background in sports as far as your family goes as well, with your uncles involved in baseball. I read that you graduated from Columbia College, Chicago in 1981 with a degree in design, marketing, and visual communications. How do you find the contrast between what you were doing back at that time at university compared to what sort of technology that people would have access to today in terms of completing a similar design degree?
The world was completely different. It's a horse and buggy compared to rocket ships. I mean, back in 1981, there was no Macintosh computer. There was no technology in place to allow you the speed and the accuracy and the beauty of the work that's done today. Even though I got a degree in graphic design just a few years even before that, the term for that industry was commercial art. I'm in the way back machine. But what I did learn a lot in those early years is that the idea was really important. And so we would spend, I think, more time back then on what the idea was and craft the idea before we'd put pencil to paper and bring out markers and start to do photo shoots and spec type and do all those manual things that we did back then. And so I had a very good grounding in the early 80s. And I think that I learned a lot about think out a problem before you jump in and just jump into Photoshop or Illustrator and start going on the computer and coming up with ideas. So I'm fortunate to be a pretty good sketcher. And so even today, I sketch out my ideas before I jump on the computer and start doing layouts, because I've always felt like it's better to take a little step back and give yourself some options to go in a lot of different directions before you really start cranking it out on the computer. Because once you have the idea, it's just pursuing that. It becomes a much easier process. And so those are some of the early lessons that I've learned that I carry over some 35 years later in my business today.
Good to hear that you still rely on a bit of paper before you actually get involved on the computer and start using all the technology. In the late 1980s, you were a design director at an advertising agency, FCB, I think it was, in Chicago. Were you involved in any sports-related campaigns? And at what point did you first appear on the radar of then-NBA commissioner David Stern?
In the middle 80s, I was working at a company here in Chicago, a very popular shop called Frankel & Company, and their largest client was McDonald's. And so at kind of the ripe young age of 26, I was working on the McDonald's national account. And so that was my really big break into the business because I got a really strong fundamental grounding in branding for a large corporation with good budgets, enormous exposure, and some very talented people that I worked with. And back then, a couple of the projects I worked on was, I don't know if this is in Australia or internationally, but we had a product called the McDLT sandwich, which is a hot stays hot, cool stays cool hamburger that McDonald's was pushing. And so I was working on new products then. Along with that, I worked on the first ever Monopoly promotion at McDonald's.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So I've got a little bit of claim of fame off the sports grid.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was really great. I won some awards, and we did some beautiful art direction work for it. And the illustrator I worked on, Paul Rogers, actually does a lot of work for the LA Dodgers even today. So it's kind of funny what a small world it was. But I had no idea that I would ever be on a sports path back then. But about that time, McDonald's really started investing and putting resources against McDonald's sports marketing, which is a very new term in 84 and 85. And so I worked on creating a whole signage package and program for them that took the classic McDonald's arch with the word McDonald's in there and changed it into a sports arch, which is much bolder, much more graphic. And that arch is even used today, some 35 years later, on all of their events around the world. That was my first dip into sports design. I didn't really even think about that when I graduated Columbia College in 81. There was no such thing as sports design back then, Adam. It was just people doing ticket designs or posters or whatever, but there was no formal path to pursue a career in that industry. At the same time, what was happening was people at the agency, the top creative people, didn't want to touch sports. It was kind of a taboo. It wasn't something people were that interested in, especially some of the more senior designers. And when some of these projects started walking in the door, I embraced them. I grabbed them. And I said, yeah, I'd like to work on a large fry for small fry promotion with Michael Jordan. Okay, I'll do a photo shoot with Michael Jordan and the muscular dystrophy boy. I'll take that assignment. And sure enough, I worked with Michael Jordan for 2 days. We did the still shoot up at the Berto Multiplex up in Deerfield, Illinois, where the Bulls trained. And the next day we came back and worked with Leo Burnett in the photo shoot and the video shoot with him. Those projects were starting to come my way. In 1987, at the same time, my account executive, my partner in crime, as we call it back in the agency days, Judy Shoemaker, was working with me. She was my account manager. And so she said, I'm going up to Milwaukee. We're going to do this thing called the McDonald's Open. And it's a round-robin tournament with the Milwaukee Bucks, Tracy Merlon, and the Soviet Union team up in Milwaukee at the Bradley Center. And I'm like, okay, we're going to need a lot of collateral materials for that. We're going to need tray liners. We're going to need ticket designs and, you know, yada, yada, yada. And we're going to need some art created for that. And so that was another chance to jump on that project. I'm like, I'll do this. You know, not to pat myself on the back, but we did some really nice, beautiful work for that project. When Judy was there up in Milwaukee, she met Commissioner David Stern. And so we're together a couple days getting the tournament organized. David was a much more hands-on person back then. You know, Russ Granick was involved. And this was the first time that the FIBA was going to let the NBA work in a tournament together. It was very successful. I think they sold out the championship game. During this time, Judy and David kind of hit it off. David saw Judy as a kind of a trailblazer in sports marketing, a woman who definitely has a vision for what needs to be done, you know, on site at an event. She had a very good background working for Bill Veeck at the Chicago White Sox, who was a pioneer in sports back here in the States. Judy came back, and within 3 months, she had left for New York, and she was hired as vice president of marketing for the NBA, working for directly for David Stern and Rick Welts, who was the president of properties at the time. So this is early 1988. I kind of missed Judy. It was kind of sad that she left. I kind of felt bad. I continued to work on some sports marketing projects and didn't think too much more about it. Early in 1990, I got a call from Judy and she said, you know, we're out here. We have design firms working with me. They're overcharging me. I know it. We're too busy. I can't keep up with it. I need some control over the brand. I need somebody to oversee all of our art that's coming in and out. This league is exploding. You know, I'm having a hard time keeping up and I've got the okay to start hiring a big department. Would you like to come on board and be the creative director? And I just got married at the time. And I was like, well, Judy, I have to think about it because that's a big commitment. Of course, in the back of my mind, I'm like, am I really being offered the chance to be a creative director for the NBA? And so I flew out in May of 1990 to meet David Stern and Rick Welts, who's kind of the leading, you know, overseer of the Golden State Warriors right now. And responsible for building the new arena out there and was just elected to the Hall of Fame this past summer, and Judy. And we negotiated for about half hour. You know, one of my favorite lines from David is he looked at my portfolio at the time. We really weren't working off of any laptops yet or anything like that, God forbid. And he's flipping through the pages and I had a lot of my sports work in there and he realized that I had done the McDonald's Open and he's like, I really love the work on this thing. We'd really love to have you come on board. So, you know, I gave him some ideas on initially on salary. You know, he like choked on his coffee and he said, you want to know how much? You go, well, listen, I'm coming from Chicago. I'm coming to New York. My cousins told me that you better add quite a bit to your salary because it's expensive here. And I started explaining. He's like, hey, you've thought about this a little bit. Huh? I go, yeah. He goes, you know, you really should be paying me to work here. Like, you realize that you really should be paying me to come to work for this opportunity because you'll never have this happen again. Me being a little naive, I said, well, that's fine. I mean, I'll go back to Chicago and I'll go back work in the agency business and I got a nice life there. Really, there's no reason for me to come here other than to, you know, see what this is all about. But if you think that that's something I should do and maybe take a chance. So he started selling me, we're going to do all these things and there might be this and there might be that. So I'm like, okay. So within 2 weeks, we got back to Judy and I accepted a job there and I started on June 1st of 1990. Having no idea what I was in for. I don't think they had any idea of what we were in for. We really didn't know. I was the 158th employee hired there at the time. And I think by 1996, they had over 1,200 people working around offices around the world, not only the United States. So wow. I was in early. You know, I was like a penny stock. I got in there early, and I never regret making that decision. One of the best decisions of my life.
Thank you for elaborating and sharing those details.
Listen, I never thought I can combine my passion of graphic design because I love graphic design. It's part and parcel of who I am. And I'm a sports fanatic. So to be able to take those two passions of mine and merge those into one and do it for over 35 years has been a real blessing. I consider myself really lucky because I never really consider this work. There's sometimes it's difficult to do proposals or whatever that are part of the business scheme that's what comes at you. But to be able to do this consistently for 35 years is quite a privilege.
Remarkable. If you began work with the league back in 1990, to the best of your knowledge, you must have been one of the first professional leagues that implemented a creative director role.
I think I was number two. The NFL had a long and storied career in that business. Pete Rozelle used to be the general manager of the Los Angeles Rams, and when he slid over, he was working with a guy named David Boss at the time on Rams projects in 1960. As he became the commissioner of the NFL, he reached back out to David Boss and asked him to start the first NFL properties division. So the first true properties division of the leagues, which services all the licensing and all the apparel and all the, you know, hard goods that you see, those usually come out of divisions called property divisions. And so in 1963, the NFL properties division was founded. So think about how far back that goes compared to 1990. David Boss has since passed. He's one of the Mount Rushmore faces in sports design, you know, even today. And he went from a small in-house group in Los Angeles in 63 to over 30 full-time employees in the late 80s. So when I went to New York, there was an article in this trade magazine called Communication Arts all about NFL properties. And I read through that five or six times and kind of studied how he built the department and what it consisted of. I use that as a kind of a roadmap for myself. I never had a formal business plan, and David hated business plans. David said, you know, the business plan is in my right-hand drawer. It's a Skittles or something. You know? He was not a guy that liked business plans, and so that's how entrepreneurial he was. But at the end of the day, I really did use that as my kind of quiet roadmap to get me to where I needed to go. And that layout consisted of not just creative people. You had an account team, just like an advertising agency, that would manage the projects. You had some production managers that would oversee printing and all the pieces that would go, collateral pieces that would go out to the marketplaces. You had a brand identity person or two that would help you with the logos. And then you had the designers that would do the day-to-day work. I used that as my model. Shortly thereafter, I was hired in June of 1990. The first creative director for Major League Baseball was hired, a woman named Ann Osie, who's, again, one of the faces on Mount Rushmore of brand design. Ann started about 3 months after I did, and we've been friends for over 35 years. Ann works at Major League Baseball still today, and I count on her as one of my clients. We do a lot of work for Major League Baseball today, so that relationship has lasted almost 40 years. She's one of my kind of heroes, but we were partners in crime during the 90s and 2000s because we would share stories, we would share people that we thought were good in the industry, you know, what kind of rates we were paying. We were definitely competitors on the field and on the court, but off, we were counterparts. We would want to study what we were doing as best practices and to learn things that we would do that they might pick up off us, and I would study what she did. And we used to share All-Star Game ticket packages together. So she'd come to the NBA All-Star Game, and I'd go to the Major League Baseball All-Star Game. And it's been a great relationship. I look to her as a trusted ally, but that's how long ago this all happened. 3 years later, the NHL hired a guy named David Haney to do the same thing, and David did that job for like 7 years. So, yeah, we were the second on board. The NBA was the second on board, and there was just a lot going on then.
Fantastic background there. So the Charlotte Hornets were added to the NBA via expansion in the 89 season, and you weren't with the league at this stage, but fashion designer Alexander Julian was largely responsible for the team's look that included teal and purple. Do you have any memories of Charlotte's arrival to the league and any impact that may have had on the design at the time?
Yes. I mean, I think that there were some things that they did that were definitely unique. One of the biggest parts was traditionally, Adam, at the time, when, let's say it's 1988, I'm going to make this up, the Detroit Pistons need a rebrand or they want to create new uniforms. The team equipment manager would be responsible for that largely. And he would go and meet with a company called Metalist Sandit, who was a partner at the time for uniforms. And they would go through a catalog of different styles that they had in the catalog and different fonts that were within the catalog. And they would kind of mix and match to put the designs of those uniforms together. And then they would get samples and fit the players. And that's how the design of the team uniforms at that time happened. In 1988, some things drastically changed. With the Hornets coming in as an expansion team, George Shin, who was the owner of the Hornets at the time commissioned Alexander Julian, a designer, not an equipment manager, to design the uniforms for the Charlotte Hornets. And Alex, his color palette was these bright pastel-y colors, including teal and purple and a light blue. And he had these like fun green colors. They were very different for anything you traditionally see in sports, which is basically royal blue, navy blue, red, green, bright yellow, and black. There wasn't a big spectrum of color in the late 80s. And so when the men of teal, as they were commonly referred to, unveiled their identity, I think it caught a lot of people by surprise. And I think a lot of people saw the potential of what could happen with using a designer to design a team uniform instead of an equipment manager. The same year, it was ironic that the Indiana Pacers commissioned a Florence Griffin Joyner, who was at the time, an Olympian in track and field, and she was the designer of the Reggie Miller, Rick Smits era Indiana Pacers uniform that were so popular in the early 90s. Mm. So although Alex gets a lot of credit for the Charlotte Hornets branding, there was another person who did not have a design background, but who was very fashion conscious in Flojo, and she designed the Pacers uniforms. And so things happen then, and that's a transitional shift. You know, that's a disruptive happening in the sports industry. So all of a sudden, the leagues, especially David Stern and the people at the NFL and Major League Baseball, realize that, hey, you know, maybe we'll take the design process away from the teams and we'll bring those back in-house into the creative services divisions that we're building. And we'll look at these less as team logos and team uniforms and more as sports brands, you know, that the Bulls are a brand. And that, you know, when we're going to launch the expansion, Raptors and Grizzlies, we're going to look at those as team brands rather than team logos and uniforms. That was a seismic shift that happened, not because of Alex himself, but because the leagues were getting more sophisticated in how they were approaching building their businesses. So they were using experts who had degrees in graphic design and understood type and understood legibility and graphics, and they let those experts do their thing. And so that was a very interesting shift in the early 90s as to how a team would approach a uniform design.
It makes sense when you talk about it, but I hadn't actually put it together in my mind that equipment managers were actually responsible for, or were largely responsible for, designing what a team's uniform may look like in concert with the league outfitter at the time. So that's fascinating stuff.
Yeah, there's a second part to that. In 1989, you know, around that era, the Apple Macintosh is becoming accepted in the industry as a production and design tool. That was not happening in the mid-80s. And so what happened is I was building out my department, and the other departments were doing the same thing in the other sports. The Macintosh became commonplace, and we needed designers who could work in Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign, and some of those programs. That freed up the world to do more provocative graphics. And so that was another thing that was a really seismic shift in the way sports design was going to be done. And it leads into some things later on, but that's a very important part. Some very volatile things are happening. In-house creative service divisions are being built out. Technology is rapidly advancing, and the sophistication in how the leagues are looking at their teams instead of just as teams and more as brands is happening all at once. And it's become kind of a perfect storm to set up to what happens through the 90s. And the explosion in licensing, and the explosion in licensees, and the explosion in the acceptance of sports as fashion, it's all really churning at this time around that. Just about the time I walked in the door at the NBA, I don't take credit for it. It's just right place at the right time.
You were only in your early 30s when you began working with the league. The following is an excerpt from your LinkedIn bio. Quote, in 3 years, built a 25-person in-house creative services team from the ground up, end quote. You've alluded to it a little bit just in your previous response, but how did you go about building that team and employing some of the technologies which were now becoming available to you at that time?
We found a really talented person. Her name was Kim Mason, and she was a designer who had a really rich technical background, and she was experimenting with a lot of the technology with a Mac. And so she was my first full-time hire at the NBA in late 1990. And so Kim was the one that was going to be the bedrock of building out the technology part of our creative services division. Rapidly after that, I hired a couple other designers who were very talented. So what I was looking for as I was building out these departments was very talented designers who were very flexible, that could work in a lot of different mediums, they didn't have to have a deep grounding in sports design because guess what? No one had a deep grounding in sports design back then. It was just in its infancy. So I knew I can explain how to put together a great looking basketball poster or a cool looking basketball uniform. They didn't need to know all the rules and regulations and get caught up in the nitty gritty of how basketball rules and how the game flowed. I would take care of that. I would be kind of their liaison to make sure that they were hitting the right temperature and the right looks for what we wanted to do with the NBA brand. But they had to be flexible because we were doing a lot of things simultaneously. So it expanded quickly. And like I said, we looked to not only having creative people on staff, but adding account managers who could oversee the project. So my designers weren't caught up on the phone all day going back and forth. You know, there was no internet then, and email was kind of a concept. People were using it, but not like they do today. So there was a lot of interaction that had to happen to keep everybody pumping at a really fast pace. So we built out an in-house division. If you took our division of NBA Creative Research and took it down the street onto Madison Avenue, you would be a 25-person advertising agency. Same rules. We had internal billings. We followed a very professional approach to how we track projects. It sped us well because we really had a lot of work to do. And David was not letting up on what he wanted to conquer in the 90s. And so we were really lucky. And we were supported very well by the front office, by David and Rick Welts. And they allowed us to do a lot of things, you know, financially and building out the department quickly to keep up with the demand.
Very interesting to hear the background of how these things came to be back at this time. You were also tasked with how the NBA was broadcast on television and later the internet. We'll get to the league's online presence in a little while, but what design factors had to be considered in terms of the game's appearance on TV during the 1990s?
There was about four key things, obviously. Number one, legibility. We wanted to make sure as we were starting to get into the design of the uniforms that player numbers on jerseys were large enough and they had enough contrast that you can really see them from a distance on broadcast. We wanted to make sure when we have messaging on courtside signage that that messaging was clean and legible and wasn't interfering with what was happening on the screen at the time. We were starting to design courts, and so we wanted to have a presence on the courts that had a little bit more organized fashion. So we started placing, for instance, like the NBA logo at the top center of the courts on all of our team courts in the NBA. So that was a rolling change that we put into effect, and we wanted to make sure when teams had their corporate sponsors like United Center on the court, they weren't too big and they didn't take up too much space on the court. So we were doing things that made the game look better on television. We worked with our NBA Entertainment division to create a look for lower thirds and stylistic treatments for interstitials and those type of things for our broadcasts. The broadcasting partners had most of the power in that, but we would oversee that from a consultancy standpoint to make sure they were not, you know, the integrity of our brand for the teams and the games were in place. And then just when we would have a new team uniform designed, we would go through the process of testing it at an arena. So we would have maybe a new Phoenix Suns uniform and we would run that over to Continental Airlines Arena at the time, the Nets home court, which was really close to our Secaucus office. And we would turn on the cameras and roll. We'd have a player come out and just do some layups and shoot some shots with the new uniforms. And we would make sure that they look good. It was fun watching Net players wearing Suns uniforms, for instance. They understood what we were trying to do. There was no social media back then, so no one knew what the hell we were doing.
I find that absolutely fascinating.
It was not like a big deal. There was no one there sitting there on Instagram posting 60 shots of, you know, Kerry Kittles in a Suns uniform or anything like that. Yeah, definitely a different time. But yeah, those were the things that we used as a basis for what the game would look like on broadcast. And then the broadcasting partners themselves at the time, you know, NBC, they would provide us with kind of the look of their season and we would have input into that. And yeah, it was a very, you know, cohesive process to make sure everything brand-wise was spot on and met the mandates of David and everybody at the NBA.
Yeah, definitely going the extra mile there, especially getting some of those Nets guys to wear Suns uniforms, etc., just to see how it looked. I think that's just fascinating to hear.
Yeah.
Speaking of the global game, we talked about the 1987 McDonald's Open a little while ago. If it hadn't already, most basketball fans would probably agree that the NBA well and truly went global by 1992. Look no further than Jack McCallum's excellent book from 2012 called Dream Team. I've learned that you were tasked with the creative direction for the Dream Team and the 1992 Olympic Games. which when I read that, I had to do a double take. Incredible to see that and think, wow, what sort of questions could I ask? But a general question, what are your fondest memories perhaps of marketing that once in a lifetime or even beyond team for the ages?
Yeah, one of the things that was really fascinating about it was we really were not true NBA employees when we would be working on the USA basketball brand. We actually had separate budgets and separate business cards because we were representing USA basketball. Those just happened to be NBA guys that were playing in the Olympics, but at the end of the day, they were really part of USA basketball. So our reporting structure was different. You know, even though Stern and Granick had their comments into everything, we also had to run things through the USA basketball folks. One of the most interesting things was we had to get the materials ready in time for sponsors to start using the group shot of the Dream Team, because it's just like the NBA rights where you have to have six or more players in any advertising and promotional use for league initiatives. We had to do the same thing with USA Basketball. So we had to get these guys all together to do photo shoots wearing USA Basketball uniform. But guess what? That was not possible because we had players traveling all around the country playing games. I worked on a program with our NBA photos group, and we put together a calendar of how we did sketches, and we had layouts done ahead of time. And what we did was we basically said, we're going to be in Utah January 10th. And so we need to get Stockton and Malone in their uniform, USA uniforms. And we want them to pose in these four different directions. And we actually want one where Carl's actually leaning on like John Stockton in the USA shot. If you see the final Dream Team shot, there's a shot of Carl Malone leaning like on John Stockton.
Yeah.
Since they were the Utah guys, and we're going to have to go and get, you know, Michael Jordan here in Chicago. And so our photographers went and then they dialed down real deep so we would be 10 feet away from everybody we shot. So we'd measure it out. The lighting source would come from the right side at a 35-degree angle. We would use this kind of focal length. We had all this planning in place. So as we were going from market to market to market to get these individual players photographed, we were still thinking about a larger picture because we were going to have to come back to our NBA offices and put this all together. And that was a really a eureka moment, I think, for David and Rick Welts to see what magic we could do with Photoshop and how we could bring together a group of guys that were never in the same zip code into one shot. And it really did allow more confidence in what we were able to do as designers. And the other thing that was happening was the technology was catching up to us. You know, we were kind of like, wow, we can actually do this. The speed of how we're doing this and the quality of what we're doing. And again, this is early 1992. So this is still pioneering with this technology and the tools that we had with the Mac. And so, yeah, that was really exciting, Adam, because we did all these different setups. And now all of a sudden we're sending these beautiful pieces of art to craft. And they're signing up because now they've got the tools to promote the Dream Team. And we're sending these materials all around the country to different sponsors who are signing up like crazy to be part of this. And so that was kind of the front of the ship, just having the materials to be able to promote this Dream Team. And then obviously getting it to the trading card company. So Upper Deck and everybody just having a field day with the Dream Team. That was putting our foot in the sand, saying, hey, we can do this. Like, we can definitely pull this off for you guys, and you just tell us what we want to do. And it was a big win for us. It seemed subtle at the time, and maybe today it seems a little bit, you know, kind of passe. But then it was definitely heavy lifting. And so I got to work with pretty much everybody on the Dream Team. I didn't get to meet Christian Laettner. That was a little bit more interesting because he was, you know, just a graduated college player at the time. So the process for that was a little bit more cumbersome. But at the end of the day, you know, I got to meet Michael and Magic. I had met Michael before, and he knew about the muscular dystrophy shoot and the large fry for small fry and Magic and that whole group. And yeah, and so it was wonderful. In 94 or 96, when we did it again for Dream Team 2, everything was already pre-set up. We had licensees sending us what they wanted. They'd seen what we'd done in 92. And so we definitely set up a system to be able to crank these things out and not have to have the players in the same place. In August of 1992, the Basketball Tournament of the Americas took place, which is the qualifying tournament for the Olympics. And that's when we got everybody together because everybody was, the season was over and all the players were together. And we were able to go back and get a second wave of photos of all the players and design them into all these different materials. And that was really a tremendous win for our department. It really spoke to our creativity. It was a photo shoot, so it wasn't like rocket science, but the ability to pull it all together and make it look like $1 million was really, really exciting.
that speaks volumes, because looking at all the merchandise and photograph back at the time of the Dream Team, I wouldn't have thought for a moment that that was put together via Photoshop or similar types of software. So that's a testament to how well everything came together. And though it is the forefront of technology that was happening at the time. Thanks for sharing those.
It seems commonplace today, but back then it was definitely pushing the envelope, absolutely.
I'm particularly fascinated by a project that you were involved with that came to fruition in the 93 season. You traveled to Arizona to meet with Phoenix Suns ownership group. I've got a brief excerpt from Jerry Colangelo, who was the then team president. He said, quote, "I want to create something modern and bold to reflect the nature of the new arena and the growth of Phoenix," end quote. Jerry was referring to the soon-to-be-opened America West Arena, which was in downtown Phoenix. So you and your design team took the opportunity to lead the Suns and effectively the NBA into new ways of branding a sports team. So all that said, what do you recall about the meeting with the Suns, your concepts for that rebrand, and ultimately the great success that it became?
Jerry Colangelo was just a very hands-on owner. When I first met him in Phoenix, when we flew out for the first meeting, he immediately noticed that I had this kind of heavy Chicago accent. He started just grilling me, like, "Where'd you grow up in Chicago?" Like, "'Cause I can tell you're from Chicago. You can't be from any place else with that accent." And we hit it off right away. You know, and he said, "I grew up this place." You know, I said, "Yeah, I played, you know, 16 in softball." Because I was a hell of a, you know, like, so it was like we were like kindred spirits almost. That was really kind of easy. It was one of the first times, actually, we're going to be doing an identity for a team with this much of a difference instead of just updating or refreshing a look like we did for the Knicks. This was going to be basically a start over. And so I was a little nervous about it because he was a very well-respected owner in the league, and David has high respect for him and what he's done for the Suns, Phoenix, and for USA basketball. It was really an exciting project because there was kind of this perfect storm happening for that 92-93 season. They were celebrating their 25th season in Phoenix, so they were an expansion team back, I believe, in 1969, and this is going to be their 25th anniversary. They were going to be playing in the brand-new America West Airlines Arena for that season, and he said behind the scenes that they were planning on signing a big free agent that year. He wouldn't disclose who it was, but ultimately he became Charles Barkley.
Mm.
And so there was this perfect storm of creative ideation happening. We just had to think big, and we had to think a little bit out of the box. The Suns had this kind of Western look, you know, in 91 with this kind of Western font on front of their uniform. Nice design, very classic. People know it and remember it fondly. But like he said, he wanted to do something more modern and somewhat futuristic that he wouldn't have to change the identity for 25 years. Not a small challenge. But what we did know was that they had a great color scheme and the bright purple and the orange. And so we wanted to keep that. The current logo that they had was kind of outdated, but we did like how it was contained. And so my vision was to kind of try to take the logo that they had back in 91 and update it, but do something really futuristic with it. And so that kind of created the streaking sun concept that we used in a logo. And so we first went through a couple of variations on the logo design for him. And initially we had the sun going backwards into the word suns, but he said, "Why don't we push it up from the bottom left to the upper right, so it's streaking across this obtuse shape that you have."
Huh.
Did that, finished it up, and then we came to uniform design time. And this is where, you know, I stayed away from the computer at this point because I wanted to have some freedom. So we did a lot of sketches of what this uniform might look like with the streaking ball in front of it. We presented those face-to-face to him, and he just fell in love with it. He thought that we nailed it. He loved the color scheme. He loved the design. We knew that sublimation, which is where a dye transfer, where you actually take a design and heat transfer it onto a white fabric, was really taking hold in the industry. You could think of cycling shirts or cycling shorts as a good analogy or an example of how that actually works. And sublimation is very popular today in sports design. And we just went for it. And we got the Suns font that we used. Everything was sublimated, and we came up with a few different designs. He really loved it. He said, "You know, this is exactly fulfills my kind of mandate. I want to have something that's modern. I don't want something pedestrian. I don't want apathy towards this. I want people to recognize and say, wow, that's the Phoenix Suns." And lo and behold, when the uniform came out, it was a little intimidating, Adam, because when you're doing something that different, you're going to be open for criticism. But it was pretty smooth. We did not get a lot of bounce back that we went too far or too different or was too cartoony. It was kind of a, no pun intended, a slam dunk for branding. People really used to love it. And even today, you know, it's, I think it's one of my favorite rebrands in any sports of all time. And I know that sounds a little ego driven because I designed it, but it just, it hit all the points that he was looking for. It seems like even today when fans see the Suns rebrand or do something different, everybody says, why just, you don't go back to the 92, 93 Barkley, you know, Kevin Johnson NBA Finals year and be done with this already. We love this uniform too much. You know, I have Suns merchandise in my office and I've got a Suns cap and I've got, you know, a jersey with my name on it that I hold dear to my heart. And that's one of my favorites. You know, they say you can't have favorites as a parent. You know, you got to like all your kids the same, but quietly, that's probably my favorite. It just changed things for us in design, and we were new at it. I mean, I joined the league in 1990, and we were doing this in 92. So that was a rapid, wow, that was a beautiful feather in the old cap for us because, again, happy owner, happy commissioner. That was a good equation to keep moving and keep pushing the envelope in design.
Thank you for sharing the details behind it. It's just great to hear this. I love the fact that you have a jersey with your name on it in that design. That's outstanding.
Yeah. I worked with a great guy named Chris Trapuca at the league at the time.
Kelly's brother.
Absolutely. Yeah. And his son Shane is going to be a punter in the NFL, I think. So, yeah, his dad was the first quarterback of the Denver Broncos. So there's some good trivia for you.
That's right. Frank.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, you're really on top of your game. Yeah, so he's a great guy, and he was the guy that had to make these things happen because he was quality control manager. So Chris was great. Love him as like a brother, but man, I'd bring some of these designs to him sometimes, and he'd be like, oh my God, are you kidding me? How the hell are we going to produce this? And I'm like, not my problem, bro. So,
over to you, Chris.
How are you going to produce it?
That's great because as fortune would have it, Chris is a future guest on the podcast as well. So look forward to chatting with him about that too.
There you go. He'll have some great backstories for you.
Fantastic. So did it take much convincing to get Champion, who were the official outfitters of NBA jerseys at the time, throughout most of the 1990s until Nike and Starter came into it in the late 90s? Was there much convincing to get them to bypass standard methods that were used at the time in favor of this more emerging dye sublimation technology? I won't even pretend to know exactly what that is.
I felt like Champion had a reputation as being kind of this cut and sew, kind of does nice sweatshirts and warm-ups and women's jog bras. They had this really place in the planet of licensed product, and that's who they were. But when they got the license to produce the NBA uniforms, they did a fabulous job. I also think that they realized that they were going to be sitting on a cash cow because they got the rights to the NBA replica jerseys.
Mm.
Yeah.
So, I owned upwards of 10 of those replica jerseys throughout the 1990s. I bought all kinds of weird and wonderful ones. Loved them.
Yeah, that was a perfect price point for them, around $60 a piece, at least here in the States. And today, kids, even at these concerts and stuff, are still wearing all those replica jerseys of all the teams and USA Basketball and whatnot. And so they were willing to experiment with us. They had a company that I think they worked with that Chris might explain, a company called Holt Manufacturing, that was really the innovators in sublimation at the time. And so they were actually pushing Holt on us to say, hey, oh, wow, the Suns, like, great, let's try another one. Let's do that. You know, they were actually with us along this kind of journey, and it was really exciting. We drove them nuts sometimes, no doubt about it, but when it was all said and done, they were very responsive to what we wanted to try to accomplish and the ways that we could do things differently than the standard way back in the 80s of kind of cut and sew and tackle twill and silk screen and those kind of old stodgy ways that don't exist as much anymore. Yeah, so no, they were a big advocate for it. They did not disappoint. They were tremendous.
This is just great information that you're sharing with us. Thanks so much, Tom.
Sure.
In 1995, you oversaw the launch of the NBA.com website, and clearly, today and back then, not sure to what extent, design and user experience obviously are crucial roles online. What challenges were involved in implementing the site, and what do you recall about the initial uptake from fans to the NBA's online presence?
Well, to really cut to the chase, in 1994, 95, when we first launched it, it was basically electronic newsletters. It was no more sophisticated than maybe a Constant Contact or a MailChimp that you'd see today. It was limited amount of pages. We were serving off of one basic server site. teams were just starting to dip their toe into it. And so we were taking the lead and trying to provide them with a look for their homepage and roster pages. And I remember a big breakthrough when we were able to send the team schedule through the internet as a PDF, and fans could go home and print the NBA schedule as a PDF online through NBA.com. And that was like a breakthrough moment. We could update promotions and we could do all these things that were unheard of back then. And so it was just basically managing a site that might be 30 to 40 pages deep. There was no video. There's nothing like that yet. And so they were really glorified electronic newsletters, really, Adam. That's all that we were doing at that time. And we were just setting our stake in the ground to start to get some of the URLs secured and some of those things that we didn't even think were that important at the time, but we learned quickly that they were. You know, we had that kind of the globe with the half basketball NBA.com logo. We started using that in a courtside signage, but quickly everybody started realizing what this World Wide Web thing was going to be, and we were quickly approached by ESPN Starwave, who in 1996, I believe, took over the site. We were just then designing the home pages and some of the inside pages for the teams. And so we got out of the technical part of that pretty quickly because that was all happening out of Seattle at the time. And so instead, we were branding the team sites for the 27 teams at the time. Yeah, 29 soon, because it was going to be the Raptors and Grizzlies joining the league. But yeah, it was not sophisticated. I don't want to make it sound more than it was, but we definitely got the ball rolling with NBA.com. And over time, we went into a situation where we'd have three different templates we would work on with Starwave, ESPN, to provide with the teams. And then we'd reskin those depending on the team's direction and their choice of template and how we would kind of color the pages and use the team logos and feature pieces. And quickly, we were able to turn a lot of those publishing techniques over to the team so they can manage their teams on a daily basis. And that was not happening until around 97, 98. So really, there was about a three-year window there where things were just happening really quickly. But that was the genesis of it. You know, I remember David coming to me in a meeting in 94, and he goes, "I'm hearing more and more. I know that you're kind of into this and you've been studying it. What do you think of this internet thing?" I'm like, "We better hurry up." he's like, "All right, so what kind of resources do you need?" We had a couple people who had some talent working on those early sites, cutting up the sites and all those good things that we did back then. And that's how it saw its early inception, and look at it today. So it was very, very exciting.
You mentioned how people would have the chance to print out PDFs of schedules and things like that back in the day. In 1996 is the first time I remember using the internet to access NBA information here in Australia. It was for the 1996 NBA finals, and I'd log on to either the NBA.com or ESPN.com sites at that time, and I'd be printing out shot charts and things like that, game recaps, and I'd put them into a folder. It was pretty sad, but that's the sort of stuff that I was doing back at that time. So I can definitely empathize with the fans that liked printing out PDFs of schedules. I was right there with them.
Yeah, it was fun.
Also in 1995, the Atlanta Hawks unveiled a new logo for the following season. And I've got most of this information, the description, via the great sportslogos.net, Chris Creamer's website.
Uh-huh.
From the stylized line drawing of a hawk's head in profile to a hawk in flight, its claws clutching a basketball. Now, that logo certainly made a statement, and personally, I really liked it, particularly the away color scheme. What do you remember about the reaction to that design from your creative team, Tom?
I think overall people loved it. The Hawks had had a great uniform in the late 80s, early 90s with Dominique and Spud Webb's design. And then they kind of dialed it back a little bit. When I first joined the league, as I recall, it was not as interesting. And so we were caught up now, and we were starting to get this, you know, sublimation machine going. And so the name Hawks, you know, just lent itself, at least I felt at the time, a big, bold statement with a strong logo. And we commissioned a great illustrator out of the West Coast, Dick Sakahara, who's well known for designing beautiful illustrations of animals. And I asked Dick to work on the project, and he did this beautiful hawk interpretation. And we loved it. We put some type on top of it. And then we then reassembled it for the uniforms during the Mookie Blaylock, Dikembe Mutombo era there with Steve Smith. And we just had a ball with those. And, you know, we threw the big hawk on the front of both the white and the red uniforms and did a lot of little gradations onto the pants. And One of my favorite articles of all time that I've ever seen is an NBA creative person was the shooting shirt for the Hawks, because basically we just tilted that on a 45-degree angle, and the thing looks like it's going to swoop down and take you and pick you right up off the court.
So, in advance of our chat, you shared some links, which were very helpful. Thank you for that. And one of them was a photo of that shirt, and I instantly was brought back to that time of the NBA history.
That was a moment in time where the tools were allowing us to do pretty, you know, outrageously bold graphics on these incredible athletes who were in the business of sports entertainment. You know, we flipped on the switch, and a lot like Spinal Tap, we were probably at 11 at the time on the volume of what we were doing with a lot of these identities. But it wasn't for the classic teams. We weren't doing it to the Celtics, nor the Lakers, you know, nor the Knicks, nor the Bulls, or even the Spurs. You know, the teams that were had classic, timeless, and great championship eras within their histories, those were kind of the untouchables, Adam. So we didn't kind of mess around with teams that had strong, solid sports brands in place. The teams that had a little bit more of a disjointed identity, like the St. Louis Hawks, who became the Atlanta Hawks, and who had those Maravich crazy, you know, green and blue uniforms, they didn't have a long team brand history. So we let it rip with them. And that seemed to be a popular design for a few years. And it didn't have a long shelf life. So it definitely kind of trended quickly, but certainly was a provocative look that I'm a big fan of even today.
I am too, no doubt. Now, just a quick side note, you mentioned there the Bulls logo. That's rarely, if ever, been really changed over its entire existence. But I did read somewhere whilst researching for this chat today that you created a secondary logo for the Bulls in the early 90s, but the marketing team was apparently hesitant to add any brand extensions in the midst of that dynasty run. Is that correct?
That's correct. We were dealing with a guy named Steve Shanwald at the time, and the Bulls were getting their rings fitted every year at the same time. We did this project for New Era. New Era came to the NBA. This is kind of a fun side note. They came to the NBA Creative Services honchos, and they came to the NFL Creative Services honchos in New York, and they came and they said, we're selling so much merchandise. There's such a demand for NBA product and NFL product. We need to have more stuff made. And we're like, well, we don't even understand, like, be creative. And we're like, no, we would like you to put together a baseball cap collection for the NBA. Like, if the Bulls had a baseball team, what would their cap look like? They challenged the NFL with the same challenge. And so we created 27 different, like, cap marks for the NBA teams. And the Bulls logo that we did was basically the B from the Bulls primary logo. And we just put the horns from the team's bullhead on top of the B. And it was like, eureka. I'm like, oh my God, this thing is going to sell like no one's business, you know? And that was originally designed for New Era, but the internal people, the NBA, liked it so much, they said, we just got to get the Bulls to adopt this as a secondary logo and put this somewhere in their identity. And the Bulls said, absolutely not. Now, there was a little other thing going on beyond the scenes there, which was like the Stern and Reinsdorf fight over DirecTV rights at the time. There was a big court battle that was going on. So those guys were not getting along very well. So anytime we really approached the Bulls to do certain things, it was kind of met with resistance anyway. So there's a longer story than just, oh, they didn't want the logo. There was some things happening when a lot of guys who make a lot of money have a fight. That's kind of the thing that was going on there. But, you know, even today, I think the Bulls have a great identity. It's just shocking that they've never added a secondary or tertiary mark to their identity, because they could mop up at retail.
Surprising they actually haven't, but I guess they don't want to, I'm not sure, they don't want to tempt fate or whatever it might be, but it's certainly an iconic design which has lasted the test of time. Expansion franchises, the Toronto Raptors and Vancouver Grizzlies, debuted in the 1996 NBA season, and you were responsible for the brand identity creation of the two teams. That said, we're going to hold off discussing this for now. You've kindly suggested that it warrants its own podcast episode at a future date.
Yeah.
That sounds fantastic. Plus, it'd be also great to touch on the 1995 and 1996 All-Star Weekend designs as well at that particular time, if you're open to it. Just briefly, what did you sort of make of the impact that those designs have had decades hence, as well as even Mitchell and Ness memorabilia, which is getting sold to this day?
I'm amazed that those four examples that you gave, the Grizzlies, Raptors, All-Star 95 and 96, those were when the machine was running at full steam, when colors and brightness and innovations and court designs and neck pattern trim and not one logo, but a family of logos, and doing things with claw marks for the Raptors and this height of trim for the native Canadian culture up in Vancouver. We were doing a lot of very cool things that I think have held their own even today. And so that's why I wanted to hold off this conversation, because I think that's a separate story, because we had to handle the Raptors in such a different way, and it was such a different methodology as to how we approached it versus the Grizzlies, and how they wanted something very traditional and very much indigenous to this market, where the Raptors wanted nothing to do with, it doesn't have to reek of Toronto. We want it to be an international brand, and we want it to be the happy meal of sports uniforms because we want kids on board. The brand philosophy for those two teams is so diametric that it almost owns its own explanation.
Mm.
Same thing with the All-Star game for 95 and 96. Those were such flashes in time, because when you think about it, you're creating a brand for a three-hour event. The game starts, you watch the game, people come to the market, they watch, you know, the All-Star weekend, and then it's over. It's like a traveling circus. It moves on to its next season. And yet, 95 and 96 designs are so popular with Mitchell and Ness. That in itself might be a conversation between myself and maybe somebody at Mitchell and Ness to try to explain this, because I don't really have a, I don't really have a good answer for you. I don't know why it's so popular. I'm just glad it is.
I hope that friend of the show and a friend of myself and my wife, Lisa, Peter Capolino, the Mitchell and Ness founder, if you're listening to this, Peter, hello to you and friend. And hopefully you might even get Peter to be involved in one way or another and talk to some of the impact that the iconic designs that you're responsible for throughout the 90s have had on Mitchell and Ness even going forward to this very day. So that's an exciting episode we can look forward to down the track. So thank you for offering to do that.
That would be great.
It'd be remiss of me to not briefly mention New Jersey's near name change from the Nets to Swamp Dragons for the 1996 season.
Yeah.
We won't go into specifics here, but there's a great Zach Lowe piece that was published on ESPN's website a few years back, and that came to be after you provided Zach with some mock-ups, most of which hadn't been seen before, of the proposed designs. Now, it does leave a fascinating what if in terms of how that rebrand would have altered New Jersey's and even the league's, for that matter, history, but quite fascinating what could have been.
Yeah, the Zach Lowe article is really interesting. I was smart enough, you know, one of the few times I used my noggin ahead of time, but when that whole project happened and then didn't happen, I was at least smart enough to go back and print every piece of material that we had done for that, from the logos to the uniforms to the courts to the warm-ups. We had a lot of work that we developed for that project, because it just couldn't stop the creativity. It was like, you know, Disney on steroids. That whole Swamp Dragon had so many articulations, and we did shield designs and simple tattoo designs. It wouldn't stop, and it was great. But before I left the NBA, I did print all this out, and I put it in a manila folder. I moved back to Chicago, and I had to put a lot of stuff in storage. And I hadn't been in that storage room much for 4 or 5 years. And then one day I was there checking some stuff, and I saw the folder, and it said Swamp Dragons on it. It was bad lettering of mine, and I just left it back in the storage space. And then when Zach reached out to me, he wanted to know about this story. And I was like, you know what? I think I've got the manila folder still in storage. We had this thing back in the States, Al Capone's vault, where like they went into his vault and looked for some stuff from Al Capone, like in the 30s. And I'm like, Zach, before you come out, I'm going to go and see if I can find this manila envelope. So I made a trip out there on one weekend, came back, and I'm like, I had it. I found the grail. You know, there it was, all there. And they had like a little water stain in some of the corners and some mold because it had been in the storage for 10 years. But like, there it was. There was Swampy staring me right in the face saying, hey, finally, you know, let's go. That really was the inception of the story. The article is so great because of how he breaks down the different voices coming into the conversation, and how David has one view of like, hey, it's the Secaucus 7. They'll find a way to screw this up. And so it'll never happen. And it's John Spoelstra, who's one of the most innovative people I've ever worked with, saying, no, we're going to push it. We're going to make it happen. You know, let's make this idea happen. He had this fury to make it work. And, you know, and then there's me. It was like, oh, I get to do another like fun, wild identity and take this boring Nets identity and rebrand it. Count me in. The way it's written, I really think it's clever because it's coming from all these multiple points, but it's all leading to the same result. You know, you just can't change the Nets. The Nets is the Nets, and that's what they are. And until they sold the team and moved to Brooklyn, it was always going to be this kind of cluster mess, you know, and, but man, I loved it, you know, and the potential of what could have been.
Mm.
I remember David, it's not in the article, but, you know, like I remember him pulling me aside. He knew I was disappointed, didn't go through, and he knew I put a lot of effort into it. He said, you know, they're not Disney. You're providing them with the next coolest thing, the Raptors, the Mighty Ducks, of everything all wrapped into one. They'll have no idea what to do with this. It's wasted on the Nets. He basically said this would be wasted on the net to me. And I think he was hoping that we could park it for some other team because somebody else would come along and we could change it. And I think that was his true feeling deep down. He's like, it would be wasted on the Nets. He was right, like he normally was.
I read the article again last night because it exploded at the time when it first came out in maybe 2015, 2016. I had a look at it again last night and had a good chuckle as I read along. And the irony was that the Nets ended up shooting themselves in the foot because 26 out of the 27 teams agreed on the change, except for the Nets, based on a twist of fate, having one of the Secaucus 7 you mentioned, change his mind at the last minute and say, no, we don't want to have it go ahead after it was finally approved.
Yeah, and it was great how it, you know, about David basically saying, they'll find a way to screw this up. Just play through, step in the way. They'll find a way to screw this up. And sure enough, right, yeah.
I read a great quote of yours from a 1996 article. Quote, "We've learned the logos are important, but the uniforms are most important. When it comes down to it, our players are so spectacular, and these are their costumes," end quote. So beautifully said. Can you just pinpoint a few of your favorite NBA uniforms of all time?
Yeah, I mean, I really love the Phoenix Suns, and still today. It'd be nice if somebody placed a call back here in Chicago and said, hey, we'd like to bring it back and bring out this, you know, old war veteran to come back and rebrand this. I've got a couple sketches that I've done with my designers back in the office here, especially my lead designer, Bridget Smith, and we've got a couple of things that are just so cool with the word Phoenix changing color from the P to the H to the rest. It's just futuristic, cool stuff.
That sounds great.
It's like to die for, yeah. And so, but you know, I'm not going to share that with somebody until they write a check at this point.
I can understand. Yep.
Yeah. The one that's kind of a dark horse, but I always loved the way the colors went. And I know a lot of people are not crazy about this, but I liked what we did with the Supersonics, the Seattle Supersonics, and the Kemp and Gary Payton years with that deeper green. I'd spent time in Seattle, and those colors felt right to me. I know people like the bright green and the bright yellow of the Freddie Brown days and their championship years and what they brought back. But I just like the sophistication of what we did the Sonics because it looked like Sonic to me. It looked like something more special. And I really love that color scheme. It's a favorite only because I think they went to the finals in it, and I just really like the color scheme and the way it all came together. So that's a good one. You know, ultimately, we didn't turn them into the Swamp Dragons, but I did like what we did with the Nets when Jason Kidd was there.
Oh, yes. Yep.
Harry Kittles and Richard Jefferson and that whole group. I thought that that was really a nice look. We had the little diamond trim down the side of the uniforms that we put on the court. And we made, that was the first logo that was kind of like a three-dimensional TV graphic, the Nets logo. It wasn't something that was straight on. We added that little rim, so it wasn't the actual net. It was just, you know, the rim of the basket with the word Nets in there. And when I saw them execute that in some of their training facilities and whatnot, they did a beautiful job with it in the silver and the navy blue and red. I think that Michael Rowe had taken over the franchise at the time. And I thought that they took something that was the mess in that kind of Secaucus 7 group, and they really transformed it into a very sophisticated corporate identity. I love the juxtaposition that I could take something as kind of crazy as, let's say, the Raptors or whatever, and do something like the Swamp Dragons even, and then say, okay, I can put the brakes on that, and I could do something really sophisticated that can have a 20 to 25-year shelf life, too. I wanted to prove that I can be versatile. I wasn't just this kind of guy creating these wacky graphics. And in fact, I could create something that was sophisticated, that had a timelessness to it, had a beautiful font treatment for the word New Jersey and Nets. And so that was really one that I liked because it was kind of like the counterculture version of some of the wilder stuff we did. I love the Denver Nuggets pickaxe logo that came back, that kind of had died, and it's back today. And I really like that identity that has been done this year. I really like what they've done with the logo. The uniform, I think, could use some work. I wish I could have worked on that with them and done some work because it needs a little help, but I do love that identity too. And I was a big fan of a lot of the WNBA identities, and in particular, I liked the Miami Soul logo and uniform we did. Not many people are going to remember that one, but that one's a favorite.
Speaking of the WNBA, you were the brand architect for the launch of the WNBA in 1997, And that included the naming and design for the original teams and also the design of the WNBA game ball even. On top of that, you also were looking after the launch of the NBA store in Fifth Avenue, New York. Do you mind just talking to both of those responsibilities and what you sort of remember most fondly or what may have been a challenge for you having them come to fruition?
I mean, I've got a lot of these favorite uniforms that I answered, but my favorite project for all my years at the NBA was actually working on the WNBA project. The chance to be at the forefront with some really tremendously talented people like Rick Welts and Val Ackerman and David Stern and company and start a women's league from nothing and transform into something that was that's had a long shelf life and popular today is, I think, a career highlight. I just today, I even get excited about the fact that we worked on that. And they allowed us a lot of freedom. Some of the team names were pretty obvious, so I was working on the naming. And so the goal was to stay, you know, brother and sister team kind of coordination where possible. So teams like the Houston Comets, you know, brother team was the Houston Rockets, and the Charlotte Hornets were the Charlotte Sting, and, you know, the Sacramento Kings and the Sacramento Monarchs. Some of those kind of reflected one another. And so those were ones that we had fun with, and they were easy logos to design because we knew the color palettes were in place. Remember, we had to share the court with a lot of the NBA teams, so we tried to keep the same color palette for most all the teams. So the Comets were red, navy, and silver, like the Rockets were at the time, and same thing with the Kings and the Monarchs. Just to see that come alive was really exciting, and to be part of innovating. Some of my heroes in sports were Gary Davidson, who helped found the WHA, the World Hockey Association, as well as the World Football League. And I loved all the uniforms and logos that he did back in the early 70s. And so to have a chance to do that for a women's league to me was a really big thrill. Those are career milestones for me. The store on Fifth Avenue was a blast. Like, never thought I'd be working in a retail environment. And sure enough, here came the opportunity to do the branding of the logo, the bags, a lot of the internal graphics that you saw on the walls, and a lot of the different sectional identifiers. The design itself of the store was done by a gentleman named Richard Altoona out of Hollywood. And so I got to work with him on some of the graphics, and I was kind of riding roughshod when he needed help on the visual side with some of the different, you know, brand things for the store. And yes, that was a big career highlight too. I can't thank David Stern for hiring me back in June of 1990s because I was able to do all these great projects at him, and that was definitely another career highlight for me.
Fantastic. It's great to have this trip down memory lane. And I think if my numbers are correct, the WNBA will be entering the 23rd season later this year.
Wow. Wow.
Recently had Mike Tebow, Washington Mystics coach, as a guest on the show as well, and he talked very fondly of his love for the league, which he's been a part of since about 2003, I believe now. So, the WNBA seems to be going from strength to strength, which is great.
Yeah.
The NBA store, my wife and I finally had a chance to visit it in person in late 2017, and I'm not sure when it actually opened. Do you remember what year it actually opened in New York?
I think that the first one opened in the late 90s, and so that was on Fifth Avenue, right across the street from the NBA Olympic Tower on Fifth Avenue and 51st Street, literally like sitting kitty corner from St. Patrick's Cathedral. And then I think it closed up during a little bit of the real estate recession in the late 2000s. They closed and they moved to the location that you visited in 2017, which is maybe like 43rd or 44th Street, somewhere in there. And so that store itself, I did not work on. I worked on the original store, which was literally across the street from the NBA offices on 51st and 5th. The store you visit is the second generation of it.
Oh, okay.
I did not have a hand in that one, but the first one was more open. I was actually at the NBA store over the Christmas holiday this year and spent more time and more money than I should have in there.
As did I.
Work, buying a lot of my old work, God forbid, you know, no ego here, right? So, but yeah, it's had a second life. I know that the rent where they were on 51st and 5th, that's now that Nike experimental store where they all kind of bells and whistles going and you can customize almost everything under the sun there. That was a fun project, and it was cranking. I mean, probably it was maybe 95 or 96 when it was built. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's going back quite a while now for sure. I did mention in the intro that you are partner and chief creative officer of Gameplan Creative in Chicago. Aside from the transition from the NBA to founding that company, you've also kept very busy with plenty of other projects along the way. I know it's almost impossible to encapsulate a reply in such a limited time, but what are a few of the highlights that spring to mind from your time post-NBA?
So we started this company in 2004. One of my first projects was actually working on an Arena Football League expansion team, the Philadelphia Soul. And my client, and I had his phone number, his email address, and can call him in at a drop of a hat, was John Bon Jovi.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I got some great stories over some beers next time you're in the States about how we would contact each other. We had kind of this alias. I would get his emails and stuff, you know, and we found this cool helmet paint for him through the Alexis book here in the States. He wanted this metallic charcoal silver color, and Wright L could not figure out how to do it for him. So I said, John, I'm going to run over to the Lexus dealer. I saw this cool charcoal silver car, and I sent it to this thing. He's like, bro, you hit it for me, man. Way to go, buddy. You tell Wright L that he's got to make this for me. So yeah, it's funny about that uniform. This is, again, small world story. The people who actually manufactured the Soul uniform and the New Orleans Voodoo uniform in 2004 was none other than our buddy at Mitchell & Ness, Peter Capolino.
Oh.
They're the ones that Mitchell & Ness uniform. If you go to Gameplan Creative and go into Sports Design and click on the Philadelphia Soul, you'll see the Mitchell & Ness logo on that Philadelphia Soul uniform. And it's a beautiful uniform, this charcoal gray and baby blue design that I just think is killer even today.
Oh, wow.
One of the first projects I did, I worked on the Charlotte Bobcats identity with Gameplan Creative. That was David's going away gift to me, so he allowed me to be part of that whole thing and design the Bobcats identity. And then into the late 2000s, I started working with the sports teams here. So I worked with the Chicago Cubs for 10 years on a consultancy basis, and I worked with the Chicago Blackhawks and did something that I never thought I would ever do. I was actually working on their game presentation for 2 years when the guys at the Cubs went over and took over the Blackhawks marketing. And in 2010, I was doing the game presentation, so you'd have the music and all the game calls and all the sponsor reads, and I was doing that per diem for them. And sure enough, they won the Stanley Cup that year, so I'm the proud owner of a Chicago Blackhawks Stanley Cup ring.
Oh, how cool is that?
That's the coolest thing on the planet right there, yeah. That thing, and when that thing comes out, look out. That thing has got its own like little, you know, group that follows it. It's something else. You want to stop somebody on the street, wear a Stanley Cup ring that's the size of a coffee mug. I usually don't walk around with that too much because I would like to keep my finger on my body. At the end of the day, yeah, so that's one of my career highlights. And we've been really lucky to work with Major League Baseball now for 14 years doing their Jewel event animations. And so when the All-Star Game will be played this year in Cleveland, all the animation graphics that you see for that event will be created by Gameplan Creative. So from the All-Star Sunday, Futures Game, Legends and Celebrity Game, Home Run Derby on Monday, and the game itself, those teams have to clear out all their inventory that hosts the game, and we come in and we do the graphics with my most esteemed client, Ann Osi, who has been, you know, invaluable to our business and a great friend. So she's the client on that project, and we've been doing that for 14 years.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. So that's something that I never knew would be on my radar screen as a big project. But another thing I picked up while working at the NBA, another skill that I never thought I might use down the road, but it's one of the biggest parts of our business today. We do that for Major League Baseball, and we do that for Boeing. We've got Boeing as a client, so we do some of the military salutes here in the United States. Animations for that. We've worked with teams in the past, like the Mets and the Yankees and other teams for animation services. And in 2015, we worked on the New York Islanders move from the Nassau Coliseum to Brooklyn and Barclays Center. We did their branding for 2 years for that. So, yeah, we've been really fortunate, Adam. We've been steady. We just did an identity project for Major League Baseball, a pretty big project that unfortunately right now I can't discuss because it won't be happening until 2020, but really excited about that. You know, hopefully we can share that with you once that launches as well.
Fantastic. Lots of things happening and plenty of things planned for the future by the sounds of things too.
Yeah, we're kind of excited. I'm going to sniff around and see what we can get for the 2020 All-Star Game here in Chicago. I don't know if we can get our foot back in the door there, but some of my comments about their branding, I might be running into a brick wall. But at the end of the day, you know, it's all in good fun.
The 1988 All-Star Game was the last time that was actually in Chicago, so it's 32 years.
Yes.
So that'll be pretty fantastic when it does happen, and I guess there'll be some sort of involvement of Michael Jordan, I'd imagine, given that 2020 is also the release year for the ESPN documentary, The Last Dance.
Yes, yes. I remember that being filmed when it was happening.
Oh, right, okay.
Don Sterling and some of those guys, NBA Entertainment at the time, were putting it all together. So yeah, no, it's going to be really, really interesting.
Don Sterling's another alumni of the podcast. I don't want to be just dropping names here, but he's another former guest of the show and he shared some fantastic stories as well.
Yeah.
Tom, it's been just great to chat with you for this period of time. You've been really generous to speak with me for so long. Thank you.
No problem.
Look forward to doing it again, hopefully in the future, where we can maybe do a bit of a deep dive into the Raptors and Grizzlies story and then also those 95, 96 All-Star designs. But it's just been fantastic to speak with you for this period of time and I wish you well until we speak again.
Same with you, Adam. Thank you so much. I really appreciate your time and great talking to you.
Thanks for listening. I welcome your interaction with the show. You can suggest topics or guests you want to hear conversations with. Leave a voicemail. Simply visit inallairness.com/voice. Click start recording. Leave your message and press stop. You can even listen back before submitting. Press send and you're done. Worldwide, the show now has over 100 ratings on Apple Podcasts with an average of 4.5 out of 5 stars. Thank you for your continued support. If you add a review, I'd love to read it out on a future episode. Your ratings and reviews are certainly one of the best ways to support the podcast. If you enjoy the show, please do tell your basketball-loving friends about it. It never ceases to amaze the number of times I get contacted via email or direct message or whatever it may be from people saying, I just came across the show, a friend of mine told me about it, thanks very much for doing what you do. As I do like to say, your word-of-mouth recommendations truly are worth their weight in gold. Stay up to date with my podcast and subscribe to my email newsletter. You'll receive exclusive details on upcoming podcast episodes, future high-profile guests to appear on the show, and much more. Simply visit inallairness.com/news. You can subscribe to my show in various ways. Search for In All Airness, 3 words, on your podcast app of choice. The show is on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Overcast, Android, Pocket Casts, and more. Thanks for listening. I hope you enjoyed the show and share my web address with your friends and colleagues. inallairness.com. Check out the podcast archive for plenty more episodes with high profile guests. Follow me on Twitter at inallairness. Please add your like to the show's social hub, facebook.com/inallairness. Join me next time for another edition of the show.